that's a good understanding. So you're trying to get to the core of the business, which is really nice. So this is introductory. So two requests, okay? Please, 5 minutes to prepare and 1 minute to present, because we have 9 such presentations. So what it is to be able to give you the certificates, I have to see that you have a good understanding on the 9 other topics that you have. Okay? So if you're not able to complete it on time, then unfortunately I cannot give you the certificates, because it's not me. I'm not giving you the certificates. My institute is giving them. Okay, I'm only representing the institute. I can plead for them, I'm the director for the center, I make a lot of calls, that's a different thing. But this is important. I need to be able to showcase to them back home, because when we go back, you know, my colleague is recording a few bits and pieces. We will showcase that. We will say, well, these are the things that we've done. It's quite important. Okay? And the person that presented now will not present the next one. Everyone gets a chance. If you have not presented at least once, I'm sorry, but you will not be eligible for the certificates. That's what I mean. Okay? So let's. I will know. I will know who's participated and who's not. Okay? We do that. Okay? Not to scare you. It's a friendly environment. All I'm saying is these are the regulations. I need to adhere to certain regulations. That's what it is. Yes? Okay. Right, let's keep going. In 2002, that's a good one by the way, excellent, well done. So in 2002, on the Antarctic Peninsula, large and weak ice shelf collapsed in the sea. This triggered a major event. I mean, so people for the first time knew that there's an increasing temperature that leads to melting of ice caps. And this is the classic case in 2002. It was all flashed in a number of major newspapers, number of articles were published. People, for the first time, tried to understand exactly what was going on. We had a number of photographs, satellite imageries, and all that, which led to us taking things really seriously. Okay, Keeling's report from Mauna Loa demonstrated what? You know? I don't know, I mean, this is a little depth, but that's fine. You know where Mauna Loa is? Excellent, very good. So, what did it demonstrate? Did it demonstrate an increase in carbon dioxide from the 1950s to the present? Or did it demonstrate that the sediments deposited in the seafloor can feed clues over the past climates? What did it demonstrate? Any guesses?
A.
Any guesses? B. Any guesses? Anyone thinks it's C? I think it's C. Any seats here? Okay, let's see what it is. Okay, yes. This is, so when you talk of Hawaii, please understand, it's got something to do with government. When somebody talks about Hawaii, this huge amount of money was actually pumped into this research by the US government. And NASA has some observatory there for their own reasons and everything. I think this is quite an interesting thing. I mean, it will keep going. If you're interested, if you keep publishing, I urge you to go to this space. It's a fantastic place. My friends used to work there. In 2003, a deadly summer heat wave in Europe killed more than 30,000 people. Okay? I mean, to me, nothing would be more evident than this, that climate change is real, because it's well, you have an increase. And of course, you know, the numbers are quite dramatic, but just look at this temperature increase, you know, 43.3 degrees in Europe, in some parts of Europe. Come on, it's just fear. Yeah? And maybe some people argue that it's not because of anthropogenic climate change, it's not because of a changing climate caused by humans. It's a natural event, is what some people argue, but by and large, I think it's quite clear. 2004, International Energy Agency said China is the world's second biggest greenhouse gas emitter of the US. As you can see, there's an increase in the production of greenhouse gases. US was number one, but China surpassed it. We have European Union, and we are emerging here. I think, and followed by Japan. Trust me, people, the way we're going, we will just surpass the European Union, and even hit the United States, because we're growing. And, well, the growth rate is about close to 5.5%. We have more industries coming in. I mean, the part of India that I come from, Madras, it's got, you know, we produce Madras as the Detroit, the East, they say, produce so many cars. The consumption of cars has increased in the US among us, in India among us people. The likelihood, the amount of money that we earn as an income, income has gone up, and therefore our consumption levels also have gone up. Well, these two reasons have actually contributed to increasing depression in people. We have clear evidence, and I didn't bring it here, but we do have data showcases. In November 2004, after Russia ratified security protocol, the 19th country to do so, so it becomes legally binding. So, as soon as Russia signed it, which is the largest country in the world? Second largest?
China.
Yeah. Okay. Third largest?
USA.
US? Fourth largest?
Canada.
Canada. No, that's okay. Well, even second was wrong, that's fine.
Fifth largest?
Greenland. Okay. Sixth largest?
India.
Brazil.
India.
Who's Brazil? Absolutely right. Seventh largest?
India.
Okay, good. As long as so you got some idea, that's right, you know. That's okay. What is the second largest country?
China.
Africa.
What's that? Sreenath. No. So, well, okay. I think about it, Russia is the largest. I think it's followed by Canada. I remember, right, but just check it out. Followed by probably US. China is slightly smaller than US, I think. Because you have Alaska, they're also sitting on top. People forget that. And then comes China. You have Australia. Can you mention that? Australia is larger than India. Is that true? Yes. Nobody mentioned about Australia. Okay, that's fine. That's okay. It's fine. There's nothing wrong with it. Well, something wrong with it, but there's nothing wrong with it. Carbon-based fuels from lithospheric reservoirs are what? They form slowly over many millions of years, readily lost from its surface in the absence of humans. How can it be seen? Yes, carbon-based fuels from lithosphere reservoirs is formed from deposition, partial decay, and compression of inorganic matter. Litter that falls from the trees, would they actually give you the large quantities of fuels that are carbon-based?
No.
Okay, are formed slowly over millions of years. People, large majority of you said C. I'm really scared now. Right, 2005, European Union Emissions Trading Scheme launched first largest scheme in the world. That's incredible. Regulated energy industry sectors with emissions close to about 40% of EU greenhouse gas emissions. I mean, this is a classical report, you should read this. And I read this with a bit of interest, and I conclude now that something is very hard for India to achieve because we don't have a great problem. We have a good amount of understanding of what needs to be done, but we don't have a structure in place to get that information, is what I think. Okay? I think, you know, youngsters like you should take the cue and then take forward what thinking, because these kind of understanding of the reports will take a number of years for us to achieve, 15, 20 years to achieve. And I think now it's going to be used, it's probably going to be used. Our Kyoto Protocol, what did it do? Did it increase federal funding for controlled greenhouse gas emissions from the US power plants? Or what did it do? Let's see what it is. Excellent. Well, they intended to reduce emissions of 6 greenhouse gases to low levels than those in E. February 2005, Kyoto Protocol takes effect, which is really nice. This is a landmark year for climate change. 40 industrialized countries to reduce emissions by 5.2% below 1990 levels by 2020. I mean, this is I've written a lot of things in here. If you're interested, you just have a look at them. I'll probably circulate some notes if you're interested. You can read them as well. Finally, this happened. This was incredible. I mean, I include this slide as part of my presentation. the final year fashion students, and I asked them to read about this report and deliberate on this, which is really nice because it's a landmark year for fashion. Again, 2005, awareness and concern about global warming hits in the US after a tough storm called Katrina. How many of you were all probably too young at 2005? So I was in the US at the time, this Katrina. One of my friends was stuck in Texas for 2 days. So we couldn't reach her. We don't know. I mean, my friend's his friend, but I had to organize something because everything went on okay. But we were all worried because there were 100,000 cars standing on the roads. And, you know, it was really, really hard. It's a little traumatic. I remember my friend getting stuck in traffic. So they have to just get out of Galveston town, which gets hit terribly in the US. But well, you know, and when this happened, US government started thinking about it. Oh my God, something else happened, and we have to do something. Now, earlier, I think the levels of understanding, I wouldn't say levels of understanding, it's not probably the right term, the engagement in terms of what needed to be done for climate change in the US was not public, although the scientists were doing all they could, like all the others did. But I think this was an open, it made this a popular subject, so to speak, in order to use the term, so to speak. In December 2005, industrialized nations that are signatories to the Kyoto Protocol agreed to set talks to introduce a new set of binding limits to take in 2012 after Kyoto expired. So 2005, in many ways, was the landmark. Would you not agree in climate change? Yes, no? I showed 3 slides. If you're not convinced, then I don't know. Yes, no?
Yes.
Okay. Right, 2006, President Al Gore's documentary, An Inconvenient Truth, is released. Do you know who Al Gore was? No. No? He was a human being, okay? That we all agree. Yes. Yes, good. He won a Nobel Prize for what? Peace? If he won a Nobel Prize for peace, why would I show him this in a climate change presentation? Oh, that's okay. You don't have to be sorry about it. That's okay. Yes? Okay, so we all agree that he was a human being. We also agree that he won a Nobel Prize. And he won a Nobel Prize to make, well, he wrote a really nice book. And, you know, I didn't read the book, but, you know, to showcase he was the one who brought climate change into political mainstream. Because without politics, that's one reason why I wanted political science students here. I wanted economists here. Because without them, we cannot solve the problem. Biologists all by themselves cannot solve this problem. Chemists by themselves cannot solve this problem. It has to be collective. You know, innovations have to happen. Politicians have to just get up and recognize the innovations. Public, the anthropologists have to come up and say, well, humans are getting impacted. Social scientists have to come up, do the research, and come up with their own data. And collectively agree that, yes, we have to solve this problem. Because it's a bigger problem, it's not a small one. It's a problem that impacts humans, insects, animals, plants, productivity, name it. It's got an impact on every possible damn thing in the world. Okay? Therefore, the bigger the problem, the more people it needs to work together to solve. Do you agree? Okay. In legislation, the precautionary principle states what? Okay, well, this is, I prepared this for master's students in the US. But you could read that. There's something called a precautionary. Do you want to guess? Do you want me to explain this? You could guess.
Yes.
Oh yeah, go for it. Go for it, yes. Okay, look at that, look at the piece. Look at the screen. Okay, let me say, okay, it's B. So lack of full scientific certainty shall not be used to postpone measures to prevent major environmental degradation. So, why did I present this slide and talk about precautionary principle? In the YouTube, there's a topical debate professor in MIT who has evidence, who has 20 people, 20 researchers working. MIT is a top school, yes, we all know. He's got 20 PhD researchers, postdoctoral scientists working with him. Their mission is to say, climate change is not man-made. They prove this, they prove that, they publish papers in Nature, they publish papers in Science, they publish papers in top research journal articles, just to prove this point. There's another professor at the University of Cambridge in the UK. Their goal is to showcase, he's got 20 researchers, PhDs, postdocs, you know, top class research mentees. Their goal is to say, climate change is man-made. They publish in the same journal Nature, in the same science journals, and same top journals. They publish with their own results, okay? So the reason why I'm trying to showcase this is, irrespective of which side you take, you may take the side of believing that climate change is man-made and it is real. You may take sides of believing that climate change is not man-made, it's not real, it's natural. Either way, it is better to be precautious, yes? Better to think that it's man-made and reduce the emissions that we have. Yes or no?
Yes.
It's got other benefits, yes? We may still think that it's not man-made, it's not proper, it's a natural event. But we don't lose anything to be precautious. Do we? That's the approach I think as scientists we should take. We should think, well, it may not be man-made, it doesn't matter, but let me switch off the lights when I go. Let me work on, or let me promote technologies that are environment friendly or eco-friendly. Would that not be a prudent route to take? Yes?
Yes.
Okay. To err on the side of caution, how many of you have heard the saying in English? Err on the side of caution. Write it down and appreciate it. Come in later, okay? Err on the side of caution. This is exactly what it is. Precautionary principle. This is what it is. 2006, California adopted a plan to reduce greenhouse gas emissions to 1990 levels by 2020. So by 2020, here, the levels. They will work, or they'll be working, to get to the levels of emissions of carbon dioxide which is close to, which was prevalent in 1990. So they've gone back how many years? They've gone back how many years?
30 years.
Thank you. Okay. This is important, people. This is, I don't like California for many other reasons apart. This is great. We should appreciate it. When you stand the statement, we should just appreciate it. 2006, NASA's top climatologist, Dave Hansen, accuses the Bush administration of censoring what he can say about climate change. Because, NASA, as you know, many of you would apply, I insist that you apply for anything in NASA. Just go. It's a great opportunity if you had it. You must all apply here. That's what I'm saying. Whether you get it or not, it's the same. Make an application, improve in your writing skills, see that you have a nice idea, work with your people, work with your mentors, your teachers, your professors, whoever it is, and make an application, because what is in your sight is not in my sight. What is that? There's something that you have that I don't have. What is it?
Time.
Huh?
Time.
Or?
Energy.
Huh?
Energy.
No, I have the energy. I can run as fast as you can run. I have the energy. No?
Because I have
multiple
different
faces,
but you don't
have. Okay, and what else, my friend? Let me get it. No, what is that you all have, which is a huge advantage that I don't?
Because we are young.
We are young.
Huh?
We are young.
You're young, and what is it that you have that I don't have? Time? No. I think I have the knowledge. No, age. Yes, by time, yeah, exactly. So you have that, you have to use that in your advantage. For many of the applications, I'm over 35. I cannot apply. You can. You should. You must. Then my PhD students come and say, oh, well, Sreenath, I'm going to apply to this. Can I apply? I look at them, it's amazing. Okay? What is your question again?